Well, hello, friends. It's been a while since I was on screen for any Taste of Science events.
But I'm glad to be back here with you all today. My name is Pambe Bahia, and I am a neuroscientist at the University of South Florida, but I'm also the National Director for Taste of Science. For those who know my voice, you may hear it's a little off. It just so happens that my sinuses have been super blocked recently, and so today's subject of feeling like a zombie in response to an infectious agent hits painfully close to home. It's all good, though, because I'm now feeling human again and ready to learn all about some real-life zombies. So without further ado, please let me introduce today's guest, Dr. William Beckerson. How are you doing, William?
I'm doing great. How is the sound on my end?
Oh, see, now I can't hear you.
Okay. I can hear you.
Right. So I wanted to introduce William, but I'm going to let him do that himself, given that the sound is very off.
Yeah, sure. No problem. Hi, everyone. I'm an NSF postdoctoral research fellow at the University of Central Florida. And, you know, I'm going to be talking to you today a little bit about real life zombies. They're basically these zombie ants that I work with. So a little bit of background about me. Again, I work through the National Science Foundation at the University of Central Florida. And I work in primarily with researching zombie ants with Dr. Charissa DeBecker. You know, to give you a little bit of information about my background, and for maybe for some of those out there who don't know what a postdoc is, a postdoc is basically one of the many steps along the ways to becoming a professor, like you would see at, you know, like a tenure college or a university college, like the University of Central Florida, for example. And, you know, it starts with the K-12 education. Following that, you usually do 4 years of an undergraduate college, and then you would pursue a master's degree, which is usually an additional 2 to 3 years of research into a particular field. In my case, I specialized in biology. And then following that, you would do a PhD to get your doctorate of philosophy. And in my case, I did my PhD in molecular biology or disease evolution. From that point, as a PhD, you can then go directly to being a professor, which is usually the case for people who go to a more teaching focused college, or you can be more research focused, which is what I've done. And we call those postdoctoral researchers. Now, a postdoc primarily does research under the supervision of another professor that has once usually been a postdoc themselves. So we work together as a research team. So most of the stuff I'm going to talk to you today about is really a group effort. But basically, the word postdoc just refers to somebody who's already got their doctorate, hence postdoc, after doctorate, and primarily does research. But to tell you a little bit more about how I wound up in this position, we need to go back to my days as an undergraduate at Georgetown College in Kentucky. So, you know, I'm from Kentucky, central Kentucky around Lexington, and I went to Georgetown to actually become an accountant. So, you know, I took a lot of business classes, and it wasn't until my junior year that I actually took a biology class as part of a general education curriculum. So at Georgetown, it's a liberal arts college. They require you to be a well-versed scholar as well as, you know, well-experienced. So they have you take like a class in biology, a class in, you know, theology, and so on and so forth. Now, my K-12 education was also in Kentucky, and it was at a really small public school in central Kentucky. So up until this point, I really hadn't had any experience with science or biology at all. So I remember my K-12 classes were all kind of lumped together. You know, it was a pchem, which was both physics and chemistry. And we learned like the first 10 elements of the periodic table. And then in biology, we might have looked at a cell, plastic cell model, and talked about cells. But, you know, in general, I didn't really have a big exposure. And it wasn't until my experience with this general education class where I actually used a microscope for the first time. And I really vividly remember that class because basically we were just looking at pond water that we collected from the local Elkhorn Creek that runs through Georgetown. And, you know, I really wasn't expecting a whole lot. Like maybe we'll see some little specks floating around in there. But what I saw really changed my view on the world, specifically the microscopic world. So what I saw looked something like this. So on the top here is an amoeba. And you'll see this little critter swimming around in between those arm-like structures called pseudopoda. That's a paramecium. Now, basically what's happening here is the amoeba has captured this paramecium, and it's going to slowly hug it until it actually pulls it inside the cell and then releases digestive enzymes to break it down and eat it. Now, when I saw this actually happening before my eyes for the first time, I was amazed because I'm sitting here thinking, here's a microscopic organism that has no brain, no nervous system, no skeleton, no muscles, yet it's complex enough to not only recognize when a food source is nearby, but to morph itself to wrap around this food source and consume it. So after that, you know, having previously thought that the world of, you know, microbiology was just a bunch of, you know, basically dumb little bacteria floating around doing nothing, to seeing this really complex interaction between organisms, I was, you know, struck in, and I wanted to learn more. And it was, you know, hard to go back to plugging numbers into a calculator after that. I really wanted to know more about the microscopic world. So I finished my education at Georgetown and moved on to study how these microscopic organisms interact with other organisms at the University of Louisville. And that research was done with a fungus that interacts with plants called Microbotrium. Now, I won't be talking a lot about that today, but I do want to give you some background information on it just so you can understand how I got to this place where I am today, where I'm studying zombie ants. Now, with Microbotrium, it's a fungus that infects plants and it grows up into the flower, and then it actually replaces the pollen that normally grows in, or basically is normally inside male flower parts, with its own fungal spores. Which is what gives it the name anther smut. So if you look at, you know, this picture right here, you'll see that in the flower are all these black little smutty-like structures, and those are the fungus spores. So it basically hijacks the reproductive system of the plant. So the next time a bee or a moth comes to pollinate the plant, instead of picking up pollen, it picks up these fungal spores and takes them to new hosts. So it manipulates its host, the physiology, as we call it, or the physical structure of the host, to help it spread the disease. In doing this research, I worked with multiple groups with the University of South Paris in Paris, and also the University of Bochum in Germany to form this kind of transatlantic partnership to study how these microorganisms know to do this, or how they manipulate their host. And this is ultimately what led me to Dr. De Becker's research at the University of Central Florida, which, very much like the Microbotrium species, is a species of fungus that manipulates the behavior of animals. So rather than manipulating the physiology or the physical features of its host to spread, it manipulates the behavior of animals to help it spread as well. So, you know, from this point forward, I basically am going to talk about zombie ants. And before we get started, I want to quickly kind of ask the audience out there, you know, when I say the word zombie, what comes to mind? What do you think of when you see the term zombie? And if you want to put your answers in the chat, maybe somebody can read those out for me, and we can have a discussion about, you know, what is a zombie?
Well, I think my audio issues are fixed now, so.
Great.
The joys of having too many tabs open on your computer. Well, we've got one response from David, which is the song from the Cranberries from the 90s.
I do enjoy that. And the, is it Bad Wolves, or somebody did a cover of that too, a more heavy metal version. Great. Yeah, so in that case, in that song, they're talking about people being mindless, right, as zombies. So mindless is one way to describe zombies, but, you know, what else is out there? Does anybody else have any examples?
I mean, for me, it's probably going to be TV shows like The Walking Dead, right?
Right. Yeah. So the you know, the dead come back to life, roaming the world. So, you know, these are great examples of a traditional zombies. So, like, you know, zombies that are portrayed, as you mentioned, in The Walking Dead and other films and pop culture media, where the dead have come back to life and they're, you know, seeking revenge on the living and biting everybody in sight. Now, while these this definition of zombie is certainly fun and entertaining to watch, and I'm personally of the opinion that there's no such thing as a bad zombie movie. Even the bad ones are fun to watch. They're not very biologically interesting, right? Once something is dead, it starts to deteriorate. So, you know, like the ligaments come off the muscles and off the bones. So, like, even if you reanimate it, how are they moving those arms around without the structures working, you know, without a stomach anymore? How do they eat things? So when you think about the biology of these movies, it doesn't make a lot of sense. So while it's fun to watch, not very biologically interesting. There is, however, a subcategory of zombie movies that is a little bit more biologically relevant. So movies like I Am Legend or The Girl with All the Gifts or the video game The Last of Us, these are examples of media that portray zombies not as the dead come back to life, but rather a pathogen, such as a bacteria or a virus, that infects an animal and causes it to behave very differently, right? And in these are almost, you know, complete opposites of the zombies that we see in these other movies. Rather than being slow and mindless, they're very fast and aggressive. You know, they share the desire to eat humans, obviously, in both cases. But in these latter examples, it's all about biting people to spread the disease, so to speak. So it's a pathogen that manipulates its host to spread, right? And that's the trend that we're going to be talking about today, because zombie ants are a real life example of this type of pathogen. Now, in order to understand how pathogens are able to do this, we first have to talk about how organisms interact with one another. So we call this relationships where one organism is interacting with another as symbioses. There's basically three different kinds. So if you're a big Marvel fan like me and you watch Spider-Man and you're really interested in like the Venom and the Carnage characters and they call them symbiotes, the reason they call them symbiotes is because it's two organisms interacting with each other in many different ways. So there's basically three types of symbioses. The first we can think of is as a win-win situation is called mutualism. And this is a case where both organisms interacting with one another benefit from that relationship. So a great example is the pollinators I previously mentioned. So when a bee lands on a flower, it picks up nectar and it's going to use that for food. And in exchange, it picks up pollen. And when it goes to the next flower, helps the flowers to reproduce. So on the one hand, you have the bee who gets a nice meal out of it, and you have the flower that is increasing its reproduction. So everybody wins. The next type of symbiosis is called commensalism. And you can think of this as an indifference interaction. Now, among scholars, there's actually argument about whether true commensalism, as defined by one organism benefiting while the other one is neither really benefited, but also neither hurt in the process, there's an argument about whether that truly exists at a fundamental level. But I think a great example of commensalism is tree frogs. So a tree frog will hang out in the trees and it gets some camouflage from this, and it also has an elevated position away from predators. So in that relationship, it gets a defensive bonus, so to speak, and it benefits. But if you think about the tree in this relationship, the tree doesn't really care that the frog is there. It's not hurt by the frog, but it also really doesn't get anything from the frog. So we might consider this to be an example of commensalism. And then finally, the third flavor of symbiosis, which is my personal favorite, is the parasitism interaction, or the one-sided interaction. And a great example of this is a leech, right? So much so that we even use the term leech to refer to people, you know, like in society who might be like leeching off of you by like, you know, stealing your homework, or maybe they're, you know, leeching off of you financially, right? We use the term leech to describe a one-sided interaction. And in this case, the leech is actually biting this organism and stealing its blood. It's getting nutrients and it's getting energy from that relationship at the cost of what we would call its host. So in the term parasitism, you have a parasite, which is the benefactor, and you have a host, which is the individual that is negatively affected. Now, I mentioned that I'm enamored by the microscopic world. So when we compare the types of symbioses that microorganisms have, we would refer to a microscopic parasite as a pathogen, right? So this term pathogen that you've probably heard thrown around quite frequently due to the pandemic refers to microscopic parasites, basically. Now, when we talk about these pathogens, they basically include all kinds of different microorganisms. And a microorganism, as the name implies, is a microscopic organism, or basically a really small organism. And this includes things like bacteria and archaea, which are single-celled protists, or single-celled prokaryotes. There's also fungi and algae, which we'll be talking about a little bit, and things like protozoa or protists, which are single cellular eukaryotes. Examples like the amoeba and the paramecium I showed earlier are single celled eukaryotes. You can think of them as like single cellular animals almost. But pathogen also encompasses viruses. But we don't refer to viruses as microorganisms because we don't technically consider them to be living. And you may have heard this before, either, you know, on social media or in your general education classes. So I very briefly just wanted to talk about why we don't consider viruses to be living, even though we consider them to be pathogens. And there's basically 7 to 8 agreed upon fundamental properties that all living creatures have. And with viruses, they don't meet 2 of these, and that's homeostasis and growth. So homeostasis is a fancy word for basically talking about maintaining something. So in the case of a cell undergoes homeostasis by keeping certain chemicals on the inside and then certain chemicals on the outside, right? You can think of like your skin cells, keeping all the bad stuff out, but keeping the water in, right? That's homeostasis. So a lot of drugs that we make to help fight pathogens actually target this homeostasis feature. So like if you can get a cell wall to break in a bacteria, for example, and all the insides leak outside, that kills the cell. But because viruses don't do homeostasis, it makes them a lot harder to develop treatments for. Another thing they don't do is grow. So even though viruses can reproduce, as we're all very familiar with at this point, they don't get bigger and smaller. So if you think of a cell gets energy and grows bigger, and then it'll divide into 2 smaller ones. And then those smaller ones will grow and divide into 2 smaller ones. Viruses, on the other hand, all look exactly the same for per species, so to speak. So each virus is going to look the same as the same virus for its species. You can kind of think of them as like letters being mailed to a mailbox. You have a protein coat and a DNA code on the inside, which is like the paper envelope and the message on the inside. And all of them look exactly the same, right? They don't get bigger or smaller or grow in that regards. So we don't refer to pathogen or as viruses as living, but we still consider them to be pathogens because of the way that they can recognize their hosts. They can, you know, in some cases get inside the host and then reproduce that way. Now, I'm going to be talking to you for the rest of the talk about microscopic pathogens that are fungi, or basically the fungus of these individuals. And when we talk about fungi, fungi also do lots of different symbioses as well. So one example of a mutualistic fungi is mycorrhizal fungi. These are fungi that grow in the ground along with the roots of plants. And you can see in this picture that I've got here that this plant on the left here has much more lush grass than the plant on the right. And that's because it's grown with mycorrhizal fungi. So mycorrhizal fungi actually help irrigate the soil and get more water and mineral to the roots. And in exchange, they actually eat some of the roots, so they get carbon that way. So it's almost like a barter system. The fungus will get carbon from the plant, and in exchange, it will trade them more water and minerals. There's also examples of commensal fungi. So lichens, for example, which aren't true fungi, they actually have some photosynthetic algae lump in there as well. But they're kind of like the tree frogs, where they hang out on the sides of trees, and they don't really hurt the tree in any way. But the tree helps them because it gets them up off the ground and they have more access to sunlight to do photosynthesis that way. And then, of course, there are many examples of fungal pathogens. So fungal pathogens, especially of plants, cause billions of dollars of damage to agricultural crops every year. So there's a lot of government resources being put into figuring out how to stop fungal pathogens so that we can help our local farmers. But fungi don't just form symbiotic relationships with plants. They also do this with animals as well. So oral thrush is an example of a fungal pathogen that actually starts out as a mutualist. So it's a yeast that grows in your microbiota or on your inside, and it helps you with things like digestion and fighting off bad bacteria. But if you have a weakened immune system, sometimes that yeast grows out of control and you can wind up with oral thrush. You know, when we talk about symbioses, not all organisms are locked into one category. Sometimes mutualists can become pathogens under certain situations. You may be more familiar with athlete's foot, which is also like a type of yeast that grows in moist, warm environments, which, you know, basically your sports socks after you've played basketball or soccer or something like that makes a perfect environment for them to grow, which is why it gets the name athlete's foot. And then chytrids are another example of a fungal pathogen of animals that are really dangerous to amphibians. So it's like athlete's foot in that it eats the skin, but it eats the entire skin of the amphibians, and it's really contagious. So it can wipe out entire populations of things like frogs in a matter of weeks. So it's also a really well-studied organism in trying to figure out how to protect the frogs. Now, regardless of the mechanism that fungi interact with each other, they all have two major components and interact with the world by using the second of those components, which is the mycelium. So when we think about fungi, they have two structures. They have the mushroom, which you're probably more familiar with. We call this in science a fruiting body. This is the reproductive part of the mushroom. So it's like the flower of the mushroom. And you know, this is what you would find on your pizza or you chop up and put into your salad at home. But it's actually the smaller portion of the entire biomass of the fungus, where the other half of the fungus is called a mycelium. And it's like a web that grows under the ground. And this is where you find most of the bulk of the fungus. So it's this mycelium that actually interacts with the world around it and recognizes things and performs things like external digestion. So while we perform what you might call internal digestion, where we put food in our mouth and then we secrete saliva and it helps digest the food, fungi do external digestion. They secrete their version of saliva into the environment, and then they usually grow on top of their food, as many of us are familiar with, right? If you've ever had a loaf of bread that you left out too long in your cabinet and it may have become moldy, that's an example of external digestion, where the fungus is growing on the bread and secreting enzymes and digesting it that way. Now, another thing to point out is when you see mold like this, you may be tempted just to maybe cut around the moldy part and then eat the rest of the bread. But as I mentioned before, the fuzzy part is actually the fruiting body, the mushroom of the fungus. So by the time you can see these fruiting bodies, there's already a massive, extensive microscopic highway of hyphae growing throughout that bread. So it's my recommendation, if you ever have moldy food, just to throw it away, because some of those molds can be very toxic.
I have to interrupt you there just to say, today I learned. I need to make sure I throw that stuff away.
Yes, but not all of the molds are bad for you. So some molds are actually used intentionally to soften food, as is the case with blue cheese. So blue cheese uses a species of penicillium to actually help make the cheese softer and sweeter. And then you can actually eat that mold. However, most of the molds that you would just find floating around your house are not ones that you would consider to be edible. So, unless you're doing this under supervision or know what you're doing and infecting them intentionally, I would just highly recommend throw everything away.
One to remember.
And this kind of brings me to the zombie fungi, because zombie fungi, like these molds, secrete chemicals into their host to manipulate their behavior. And they do this to help increase their ability to spread. So in the case of zombie ants, they manipulate their behavior to cause them to go up to higher locations so they can use the wind to spread their spores to more ants below. Now, I'll briefly talk to you about the host real quick, and then we'll get into the cool fungus stuff. So Ophiocordyceps, which is the zombie fungus that infects these ants, usually infects carpenter ants. And the reason it does this is because they're big, right? So in order for them to have enough meat, basically, for the fungus to eat and have enough energy to grow that mushroom, it needs a bigger ant. So you don't ever see these Ophiocordyceps infecting things like fire ants or sugar ants that you would see on the pavement. It's usually those really big girls that you see crawling around. Now, even though they're limited to big ants, they have plenty of host opportunity. If you look at this picture here, everything shown in green is where you can find carpenter ants in the world. So it's pretty much everywhere except for the polar ice caps. So these fungi definitely have enough of a food source. Now, if we overlay where you can find these zombie fungi onto this map, you'll see that it's not nearly as ubiquitous as the host. There's a couple reasons for this. One is that we're just beginning to discover all these species of fungus, so our map is incomplete. But even with our incomplete map, you can see that there are some regions where you don't tend to see zombie fungi. You don't tend to see them in the Midwest. You don't tend to see them in Northern Africa or in the Middle East. And that's because these regions are very dry. And as we talked about with athlete's foot, fungi like moisture and heat. And in the case of Ophiocordyceps, they're kind of like Goldilocks because they like things to be warm but not too hot, and they like things to be damp but not too wet. So they're kind of like the Goldilocks of fungi. Another interesting thing we see when we look at zombie ants is each example of different species of carpenter ant seems to have a different species of Ophiocordyceps, or the fungus, that infects and manipulates that host. And what's really interesting, and what, you know, really caught my attention for the research that I do, is if you take these fungi and try to infect other carpenter ants with them, they're unable to manipulate the host behavior, and they cannot form that mushroom fruiting body. So we call this host specificity. All right. So host specificity is just a description for what host each parasite can infect. And you may be familiar with this concept because of the coronavirus pandemic, right? So when we think about SARS viruses, for which the coronavirus is included, that usually has a host specificity maintained to bats. Now, as we're all well aware, sometimes the host specificity can change. And when this occurs, we call this a host shift. And we think that's exactly what happened with this Ophiocordyceps zombie fungi, because we can compare this to a closely related group of Ophiocordyceps that infects beetle larvae on the forest floor. So what we think occurred is that you have this pathogen that infects beetle larvae that managed to jump hosts over to carpenter ants, and then over a long period of time has evolved to manipulate their behavior to cause them to climb up trees and increase their spread where they weren't doing so with beetle larvae, which grow actually in the ground. Now, if we look at, you know, all the different species out there, every year we're discovering dozens of new examples. So just in 2018, we found 15 new species of zombie fungus, most of which were in the rainforest, which has a huge biodiversity and lots of different ants and lots of different fungi. And you can note that if you look at all these examples, each of the fungus looks slightly different, right? So it's a slightly different species with slightly different physiological traits. So that's those physical characteristics I was talking about. And so much so that host shift doesn't seem to explain why we see so many different fungi, right? Because if host shifting was what caused them to infect new hosts, you would think that they would look more similar than they do. So what we think is occurring here is, in addition to host shifting, there may be something involved with how the parasite changes with its host over time. And in order to understand this, you have to think about the host of the parasite as being the environment for the microorganism. So a zombie fungus is to the ant host what basically we are to our planet. We can't survive without the oxygen and the water that is on our planet. So if our planet changes, then slowly we will change over time too. So what can happen is, let's say you have an Ophiocordyceps fungus that infects an ant, and it infects the whole population, right? But maybe something happens, like, you know, a rainstorm event that washes some of the population away and separates them from the original population. Now, if this barrier is maintained over time, what will happen is the two populations that used to be identical will start to change in different ways, adapting to their new environments. And because the host is changing, that causes changes in the pathogen as well. So we call this coevolution, when two things are basically changing together. So the pathogen relies on the host. So any changes in the host will cause changes in the pathogen as well. And if this is left long enough, this can lead to speciation, which is basically just a term used to describe the formation of a new species. In particular, this is a form of allopatric speciation, which is where a reproductive barrier causes the two populations not to be able to exchange genes and therefore stay the same population. And over time, different mutations pile up. And if that goes on long enough, they become completely different species. A great example of this is actually snails, because they're so slow. If you have like a big rainstorm and it tears a big chunk of the earth out, then you can actually have this geographic barrier. And I have a TikTok channel called A Bit of Biology where I talk about this and how Pokemon, the game, has used this in their Pokemon Gastrodon, which is a snail that, if you find it on one side of the mountain, is blue. And if you find it on the other side of the mountain, is pink. So I do a lot of pop culture stuff in addition to a lot of my zombie research. So if you're interested in that, I highly recommend checking out that page on TikTok. But getting back to the zombie fungi, regardless of how these different species have evolved, they have to be able to infect their host. So let's talk about how these zombie fungi do that. So Ophiocordyceps is what we call an ascomycete fungi, or a sac fungi. And the reason we call it a sac fungi is because if you cut open the fruiting body, which is the mushroom there, you'll see that on the inside, you have all these hair-like wispy spores that are encased in multiple different sacs throughout the mushroom, hence the name sac fungi. Now, these sacs actually can fire the spores out like harpoons, so it helps them get range that way, but then also, by being high in the air, they can float on the wind to a much further location. So what happens is these spores float down onto the floor, and they can either land onto new ant hosts directly, or more likely, they'll land on the floor, and they'll basically stay there until an ant steps on them. And these spores have very protective coatings that can allow them to survive for, you know, in some species of fungi, thousands of years. So it's really just a numbers game. A bunch of spores are laying in wait, kind of like landmines on the floor, and eventually an ant is going to step on one. Once the ant picks up that spore, the fungus then grows into the ant. And for the first couple of days, it's all about establishing itself inside the host. But following that initial establishment period, the fungus starts to secrete those chemicals I talked about that change the behavior of the host. And some of the behavioral changes that we see are these very antisocial behaviors, pun totally intended there, because ants are social creatures. They form roles and jobs within their nest. So when they're infected, you'll see that they'll actually abandon the nest, which is really unusual for a very social creature. The next type of behavior that we commonly see in Ophiocordyceps infections is called summit disease, which is where the host begins to climb. Or in the case of like wasps, for example, that are infected by Ophiocordyceps, they'll fly. So summit disease basically is what the fungus basically induces in the host to get them to get up so that they can spread their spores better. And this is what allows this trait to be advantageous for the fungus. Now, once the host is on the periphery of plants, which means the very tips or the ends of like the branches or the stems, what you'll see is the final behavioral manipulation called the death grip. So as you can see over here on this close-up, this ant here, she's biting into this leaf and doesn't let go. What this does is it anchors the ant to that leaf so that it won't fall out of the tree if there's like a strong wind. It's at this point that the fungus then starts to eat the ant from the inside out and then grow using that energy, the mushroom, usually out the back of the head because that's where the head meets the thorax and it's relatively weak compared to the other parts of their shell. So it'll grow out the back, form a new fruiting body, and make more spores, which it can then fire out onto the wind and repeat the process. Now, as a research group, we're interested at the University of Central Florida in how the fungus does this, right? How is this microorganism manipulating the complex behaviors of an animal, right? So one of the first things that Dr. De Becker did in her lab when she was starting out was to look inside the ant to see if we could get some idea of what's going on in there. So this is what an ant brain looks like. not too different in structure to ours, but very different in complexity and size. But what you see when you look inside the ant is the fungus will actually eat and grow into the muscle tissue and the fat tissue, but it doesn't disrupt the nervous system of the ant. And instead, it kind of grows around it like a fungal cage. And we think it does this so that it can prime itself to secrete these compounds directly into the nervous tissue to manipulate the behavior of the host. So to talk a little bit more about this behavioral manipulation, let's look at what an ant normally behaves like. So here you'll see in slow motion, an ant that's walking. And it's doing the normal left to right, like one does. But you'll also notice that it's doing something with its antenna called antennation. It's waving them around in front. And what it's doing here is it's smelling for chemical cues left by other members of the nest. So they use these antenna to communicate with one another. They use them to follow trails. They use them to feel out in front of them. So they're very involved with these antenna. Now, if instead we look at an infected individual, so here's an individual we've infected in the lab, you'll notice that it's no longer doing that antennation. And in fact, now they look kind of like antlers. They're kind of stuck in one position. And right here, you'll notice that she'll bump into one of her sisters and have no interest in communicating. And that's really unusual for ants. Usually when they meet each other, they'll smell one another with their antenna, like say, hi, how you doing? you know, make sure that you're part of my group and not part of a different group. And they'll talk to each other about what they're doing in terms of their roles in the nest, whether they found food and all these things. But with infected individuals, they're completely antisocial and they're not antennating. And you'll see that they're kind of fumbling around and falling over and just running in random directions and continually hyperactive, right? And then here's an example of the death grip. So the reason I wanted to show you this video is to show you that the ant is not particularly happy about this situation, right? You can actually see it's kind of trying to pull itself off of this piece of air moss that it's latched onto. So it's unable to let go of its death grip. So here we have an organism that is infected with a pathogen that is now antisocial and has trouble with motor coordination and is kind of wobbling around and is very hyperactive and has a tendency to bite things. Does that sound familiar to you? Because it sure sounds familiar to me. But if you need even more examples of why we call these zombie fungi, take this for example. Here's another behavioral manipulation we commonly see in the ants in Florida. So ants in Florida are nocturnal because it's so dang hot during the day that they can become dehydrated and basically die because of the sun. So a lot of their work is done at night. So they have a circadian rhythm, which is basically their sleep-wake cycle that tells them, hey, it's nighttime, time to go do work. And when it's daytime, it's time to sleep. Just like we have a circadian rhythm that tells us when it gets dark out, it's time to go to bed. And in the morning, when the sun comes up, it's time to get up and eat some breakfast. Now, something interesting happens when you infect these ants with Ophiocordyceps. So on the left here, we have a container of uninfected ants. And on the right are all infected with Ophio. So on the left, you see when we turn the light on, the ants pretty much finish up their jobs and they go into their little nest, go to sleep. But on the right side of where the ants are infected, you'll see that even though it's daylight to them, they're still running all over the place, right? So their circadian clock has been disrupted in some way. And now they're just completely, you know, always hyper running around, roaming the earth. So again, we have an organism here that is infected with a parasite that is causing them to wander the world continually in search of something to bite, right? Again, does this sound familiar to you, right? These are traits that when you watch these movies like I Am Legend that are reflected in the zombies and hence why we call them zombie fungi. Now, you can actually find these in the United States. And I know that I was invited by the Tampa branch of Taste of Science. And in Tampa, you can actually find these Camponotus ants infected, and we go out into the local, local wilderness areas and find them all the time, and we collect samples and bring them back for data. So if you're interested in trying to find some of these zombie ants, I'd highly recommend using an app called iNaturalist. And for those of you who are not familiar with the app, it's basically Pokemon Go, but for real life. So you can take a picture of a frog, or you can take a picture of a bird, and the app will tell you, hey, that is a Cuban tree frog, right? And you can actually post that data point and its GPS locations to the cloud, and real life scientists can use that to either go out and collect samples or to get a good idea of the geographic location of certain species. So if you're interested in using iNaturalist, you basically download the app and put it on your phone, and then you can open up the app's front page, and it'll give you a list of basically a portfolio of every picture that you've taken while using the app. So it works as a nice photo album, and you can share it with your friends and say, hey, look, I found this rare butterfly the other day. And here's my basically data point for that. And when the app's open, you can then select the camera button and take a picture in real time. Or let's say you're out in the wilderness area and there's no Wi-Fi. You can take a picture on your phone and upload it from your photos later on. To do that, you basically click on the picture, and then it'll give you a question that you can select to have the app actually give you a guess of what it thinks it is. So in this case, when I took a picture of this nice little yellow flower here, it said, we think this is a tick seed, right? And then it gives you some other suggestions based on similarly looking things that have been found nearby or that basically fit the criteria that is in your picture. And then it's up to you to be the curator of your own portfolio. Once you select which organism you think it is, you can then upload it to the cloud, and other scientists like myself will either agree with you or give you other suggestions. Or no, this is actually this type of flower. And then they can use that geographical point to go collect samples. Now, if you want to use the app, but you don't necessarily want to share the GPS locations, like maybe you took a picture of a cool beetle, but you don't want scientists crawling over the fence to come check it out in your own backyard, you can actually turn that off by clicking on this geo-privacy setting thing here too. So you can use the app completely for your own personal educational purposes, go out with your family and, you know, just figure out what lives around you. Or you can actually basically upload these for real life scientists to use. So here's an example of zombie ants in Florida. If you looked at this app 2 years ago, nothing was on here. And that's because, you know, again, a lot of these we're just now discovering. And as people become more familiar with their existence, you know, they're starting to look in the trees around them and find some of these and upload them to iNaturalist. So for those of you in Tampa, you can actually see there are a couple examples of this Ophiocordyceps zombie fungus that you can find in Tampa. So by using this app, you could actually open it, click on that data point and find out where they found it and go to that place and try to find some for yourself. So real quick, just to give myself a little bit of a breather, and if you got to get up and go to the bathroom, or maybe you want to go get some chips, maybe you're out of snacks, I have a 5-minute video from National Geographic about the zombie ants in the rainforest. So I'm going to go ahead and play this video, and if you got to take a break real quick, we'll meet back in about 5 minutes.
Fungi and slime molds race to decompose dead matter on the forest floor. Many spread by releasing spores up to 30,000 per second. If just one of these spores lands in the right place and takes root, it can colonize a whole new area. But not all fungi feed on the dead. Days ago, a spore landed on this ant. Now she's acting strange. A network of roots has infiltrated her muscles. Her body has been taken over by cordyceps, a parasitic fungus. It floods her brain with chemicals, drugging her, compelling her to head where conditions are perfect. Just the right amount of light, just the right amount of humidity for the parasite growing inside. It forces her to clamp down in a death bite, and Cordyceps reveals its gruesome nature. Growth. Cordyceps can release its own spores, infecting more ants, releasing more spores, infecting more ants, releasing more spores, infecting more ants, infecting more ants, more ants, more ants, more ants. Cordyceps can wipe out entire ant colonies. But more than just ants are at risk. There are over 600 species of cordyceps spread across the world. Most are found in jungles, they prey on a whole host of victims.
All right, so welcome back. Before we get into the question and answer session, I have kind of like a little test for you guys who have been watching the whole talk and give you an opportunity to kind of apply what you've learned to some examples of zombie movies. So I have two clips here I'm going to show you. One is a not so great zombie movie in terms of biology. I mean, they're all fun to watch. And then another one is more biologically interesting. And what I'd like to do is play the clip for you. It's about 1 minute long. And then I'd like you to give me your impact on it or your opinion. Do you think that they got the biology right in this, or what do you think they could have done better? And then we'll have a discussion about, you know, how biology is portrayed in film and media. So this first clip is from Resident Evil 2. And as a pre-warning, there is a loud jump scare portion of this. So if you have your volume turned way up, you might want to turn it down a little bit. And if you're a little faint of heart, maybe cover your eyes for about a minute here.
You'll become one of them. You'll endanger your friends, try to kill them, probably succeed. I'm sorry. It's just the way it is.
So there's an example of how zombies are often portrayed in the media. So in the comment section, go ahead and type in, you know, did you think that was pretty good in the terms of biology, or what are some things you noticed that, you know, don't match up, or things that you did like that we've discussed in this talk today?
This is always where we need a little countdown timer or something, because obviously there's going to be a delay between us talking and between the audience hearing it. People are reticent to answer, I think. I think you gave some tips at the beginning, though, right? Where you said which kind of movies were realistic, which ones weren't?
Sure. Yeah. Maybe I can expand on that a little bit and talk about some of the other, you know, biological issues with zombie movies and why really none of us should be afraid of this actually ever happening in real life. In addition to the physiological or the physical things we talked about, where, you know, the tendons aren't really connected anymore, in order for a pathogen to live in a host, it needs the host to be alive as well. If you remember back to the example I gave where pathogens to their hosts are kind of like we are to their planet, if the host is dead, i.e. if our planet doesn't have oxygen or water anymore, then we don't have the resources that we need to survive and thrive. So in the case of, you know, Resident Evil here, where they're saying that some kind of pathogen is bringing the dead back to life, it doesn't really hold any water with real biology because, you know, viruses, in order to replicate, need a living host in order to replicate. So there's at least one example there where the biology doesn't match up so well. So if I had to rank Resident Evil in terms of biology, I'd say it's a really fun movie to watch, but maybe only gets like 2 out of 10 brains in terms of how biologically relevant it is. So I have one more clip for you today. This one's from 28 Days Later, a little bit more interesting of a clip. So I'll go ahead and play this. And if you want to chime in, you know, during the clip or after, of some things that you saw that you thought were biologically relevant, or some more examples of, you know, flubbing the science, then feel free to post those.
hi.
Yeah, I'm fine. Say hi. Sorry, I lost my temper. Hannah, I love you very much.
What?
Keep away from me. Stay where you are.
Dad?
Keep away from me!
Dad?
Keep away from me! Keep away from me! Keep away! Keep away! Keep away!
What's wrong? Dad!
Jenny's infected!
No!
Okay, so what did you guys in the audience think about the biology in that particular scene?
People are pondering, I hope. Oh. Oh. I think we might have had some copyright issues, so I don't know if it was streaming. At least not on YouTube.
Oh. Well, if it wasn't playing properly, to give you kind of a recap of what happened, a bit of blood dropped into an individual's eye. Which is something I really particularly liked about this movie, because in most zombie movies, they talk about the bite spreading the disease. But in real life, the major way in which diseases transfer from person to person is through our mucous membranes, our eyes, our nose, and our mouth, right? What we breathe. So this is a great example of giving another way in which, you know, these pathogens in real life actually would infect people. And as a matter of fact, usually we actually contaminate ourselves by touching something with our hands and then touching our face. There's actually been several studies done that show that people touch their face an incredible amount of time, something like 10 times per minute. And you know, we interact with the world using our hands. So if you touch a doorknob that somebody who is sick just recently touched, they can transfer some of these bacteria or viruses to you by you touching that doorknob and then touching your eyes or your nose or your mouth. So it's just a really good example of, you know, how disease actually works in real life. And another good reminder that, you know, washing your hands is always a good thing. So, you know, these are just two examples of the different ways in which, you know, film can portray pathogens and how they spread and you know, use them to kind of captivate our minds with this concept of zombie or zombification. So I hope you enjoyed, you know, that part of the talk. And if you have any general questions, I'd be glad to answer them for you as we move into our Q&A portion here.
All right. So unfortunately, we had a couple of issues with YouTube because it decided it did not want to show the 28 days later clip. So hopefully our audience is still there for the Q&A portion of it. But we have a couple of audience questions. So there's one from Rob Johnson, which is, how common is this type of parasitic relationship? And does it exist between many other species? Does it affect mammals, for example?
Good question, because as we're finding out, what we originally thought was this very like unique example of behavioral manipulation is turning out to be more common than we thought. By far, it's found within a pathogen that infects insects. So insects seem to be the primary, you know, victim of these types of pathogens. But to your point, there is maybe one example or maybe two examples of pathogens that manipulate behavior of animals, primarily the rabies virus and a protist called, I forget the name of this. It's a... It normally infects rats or mice and actually causes them to be less afraid of cat. So they actually hang out near cats more and then get eaten. And it helps the the protist get back into its what we call a primary host or its first host, which is the cat. It's something gondii. I can't remember the genus of it, but it's basically a small microscopic organism that makes the mice less afraid. So that would be considered a behavioral manipulation. Now, one thing I wanted to add to that is when people get sick, their behavior changes, right? You know, if you're throwing up in the toilet, you know, that's not something that you normally do. So we would actually refer to that as a sickness behavior and not a behavioral manipulation. And the key difference between those two things is that people's behavior changes, or people's behaviors change when they're sick just because their body is not feeling so good. But a behavioral manipulation is something that actually helps the microorganism spread, right? It gives an advantage to the microorganism to cause that to happen in the host. So in the case of zombie ants, by causing them to climb up and then bite down so they can't fall out of that elevated position, the spores are able to spread better on the wind. So we would call that a behavioral manipulation. Whereas, like, you know, drinking more soup, for example, would not benefit the pathogens in any way. So we would call that a sickness behavior. But there are plenty of examples of other zombie, not just fungi, but protists and worms. For example, there's a species of worm that infects crickets and causes them to just jump incessantly until they land in a body of water and drown. And that's a behavioral manipulation because the worm reproduces in water. So by manipulating the host to be hyperactive, it helps it to get back to the water to reproduce.
Oh, wow. So Eric says, was it Toxoplasma gondii?
Toxoplasma gondii. I got some helpful smart viewers out there.
Yeah, what a smart ass.
So just to clarify on that one, it's a known behavioral manipulation in mice, and it can infect people. But whether or not it actually manipulates the behavior of people is uncertain. There is some evidence that it's causal evidence, so we're not sure it's directly related, but that it may increase your risk of schizophrenia. But again, is that really a trait that helps the protist spread? Not really. So to call that a behavioral manipulation is kind of a stretch.
Yeah. I want to say, isn't it the plot of a book by, is it Chuck Wendig, who wrote Wanderers, where essentially isn't it about humans getting some kind of fungal infection, which then creates spores, which then...
I'm not familiar with that one, but if you're interested in watching a movie about what this zombie fungus would look like if it infected people, there's a great movie that one of our collaborators was a counsel for called The Girl with All the Gifts. And there's a lot of really good biology in that movie because specifically he, was there to kind of coach them on, what makes sense biologically. So they talk about symbiosis in that movie, and they talk about behavioral manipulation. So while I'm not familiar with that one, because there's just so many zombie movies out there, I do highly recommend The Girl with All the Gifts.
I want to add to the list. So we had another question from Annalie, and it's kind of similar, but have any fungal species been found to infect multiple species, or is it just one species infecting a single insect?
So when we just talk about pathogens in general, there are plenty of examples of what we would call a generalist, or something that basically infects everything. A closely related sister to Ophiocordyceps is Bavaria, which used to be called Cordyceps, which you probably saw an example of in that movie, although I can't be certain that it's specific, or the Natural Geographic's clip, that is. But I can't be certain that's actually Bavaria. But regardless, Bavaria is kind of like a mold that just grows on insects in general. So like all insects are its victim. But it doesn't manipulate the behavior because it has such an easy time spreading. So a lot of times when we see this behavioral manipulation, it's a specific result and probably leads to a narrowing in the host range. And that's because as it becomes more tailored to manipulating that particular host, it loses the ability to really be successful in other hosts. So that was kind of a long way of saying there are examples of generalists out there, but most of the behavioral manipulating pathogens are very host specific.
Okay. So we had a random question, I think, from either Eric or David, which is, where would you put mitochondria on the spectrum of symbiosis?
So we actually, that's a good question, particularly because it is a great example of symbiosis, and so much so that we actually call the origin of the mitochondria and the chloroplast the endosymbiotic theory. And what this basically states is that long, long time ago, in the early dawn of evolution, there were eukaryotic cells and prokaryotic cells, or rather basically proto-eukaryotes, whatever gave way to eukaryotes. And at one point, it would have engulfed this mitochondria bacteria cell. And rather than just destroying it, they formed a symbiotic relationship. And through a long, long period of evolution, they've become so dependent on one another that if you take the mitochondria out, the cell and the mitochondria die. So we call this specialization, you know, and the same thing occurs in animals, like, you know, the cells in your heart can't survive without the rest of the cells in your body and vice versa. That's called specialization. So in the case of the mitochondria and the chloroplast, you can tell that these aren't the same as like the Golgi apparatus, for example, or the nucleus, because of a couple things. One, if you look at the small molecular machinery that they use to actually make proteins and stuff like that, they actually have their own set, and they're more similar to bacteria than they are to the rest of the cells in your body. So that's one piece of evidence that mitochondria used to be their own bacteria. Another piece is they have double membranes. So everything else in your cell has a single membrane layer, but these bacteria have two membranes, and that's a product of the process called phagocytosis, which is kind of what was happening with that amoeba there, where it wraps it around and it actually forms a little pocket with its own membrane that surrounds the membrane of the bacteria. So it has two membranes. So over time, that's happened. It also has its own genome, which is weird. So like, you know, your Golgi apparatus doesn't have DNA. Why would it? The DNA is all coded in the nucleus. But in mitochondria, it has its own DNA. So there's lots of examples that support this idea, which is why we call it the endosymbiote theory and not the endosymbiote hypothesis. So again, a very long-winded way of saying that is a fantastic example of symbiosis.
It's one of my favorite evolutionary stories as well. So we have another question from Rob, which is, is it the guinea worm that causes a sore that burns and makes people head to water where the worm spreads?
I'm not familiar with that one, but just based off of the information you've given me, that sounds like a behavioral manipulation, because assuming that the worm reproduces in water, and there are examples of behavioral manipulation in worms, it sounds like if in that case, it's actually causing a behavioral phenotype that helps it spread. Right, assuming it reproduces in water. Another example of a behavioral manipulating worm is one that can be found inside snails. So it actually grows in the eye stalks. The eye stalks of a snail are usually translucent. You can see through them. And the worm has like a multicolored green striped pattern. And what it'll do is it'll cause that summit disease that we see in the ants. So the snails will climb up on top of plants where they're very visible to birds. And then the worm will kind of dance in the eye sockets as like these big neon lights, like, hey, come and eat me. And so the bird swoops down, eats the snails, and then the worm actually completes its life cycle in the bird's digestive tract. And because birds fly all over the place, it can poop out more worms all over and help spread the disease. So we would call that a system that has two hosts. And we would call the bird the primary host and the snail the secondary host. Yeah, there's definitely examples of worms that do this as well, although I'm not familiar with that particular example.
So, Rob, maybe. So we have another question from Emrea, and no worries that you joined later, but they ask, are some of the molecules involved in behavioral manipulation, let's try that again, by the parasite or the symbiote, hormonal or hormonal mimicking?
Good question. The short answer is, at least I don't know. In terms of understanding how these fungi interact with their host, that's been known for about 50 years, or at least it was discovered about 50 years ago. But we are just now, in the last few years starting to understand what chemicals are being made with the advent of these like genome sequencing technologies, and in our lab testing some of these proteins. So we don't really know exactly how it's working in the ant, but there is suspicion that hormones play a major role because hormones are so intertwined with behavior. Also, there are known manipulations of hormones in plants. So the microbotrium that I talked about very likely manipulates plant hormones to change the structures of that male part, the anthers. So rather than making pollen, it puts its own fungal spores there. And a really cool thing about that group that I didn't talk about was those plants are dioecious, meaning they have separate plants that are males and separate that are females. And when that fungus infects a female plant, it actually causes it to get rid of the female flower and form fake male flower parts, probably by manipulating the hormones in that part of the plant. So unfortunately, at this time, I wish I could give you a more concrete answer, but right now I'll just have to give you a really strong probably.
I like how weird biology is. So we have another question about the ants, and it's, why are the ants always referred to as her? You did it in your presentation, and it's done in the video as well. Are there sex differences in the infections?
So a little bit of background about ants in general. All the ants that you see are female, except for drones, which are these really tiny ants that have wings. And the colony only makes drones when it's time to do the mating or the nuptial flights. So the colony will release drones, and they'll release queens, which at that time have wings, and they'll fly up into the air and they'll mate with other nests, other populations of ants. And this helps with genetic diversity, kind of like how you might have your mom's eyes, but your dad's hair, right? So by mating with other colonies, they can be more genetically diverse. But once that queen has mated with that male, the males only live for a few days and then they die. And then that's the last of you see of them until that colony is big enough to make their own males. So all the workers and all the drone, all the majors rather, all the bigger ants that you see, all of them are female.
Well, there you go. So potentially a bit more of a fun one. What is your favorite kind of human zombie? For example, chemical, fungal or spore, or demonic?
I just because I'm so enamored by the microscopic world, I really enjoy a good zombie movie where it's, you know, a virus or, you know, a fungus, for example, or a bacteria even that is manipulating the host. Again, I love watching all kinds of zombie movies, and at least in my opinion, the worse production value there is, the more I enjoy watching it. So I really enjoy those like demonic zombie movies as well. And then also just like the plain old dead coming back to life. But there's something satisfying about, maybe even a little bit more scary about knowing that they're talking about something that is at least plausible because we have real world examples of it. Whereas, you know, maybe with some of the other stuff, it's much more easy to laugh at.
Yeah, absolutely. And I have one last question for you that's completely unrelated to anything we've been talking about so far, or maybe it is. So can you explain what the tattoos are? Because you're...
Oh, yeah, sure. Actually, this arm, and I don't know how well you can see this, this is an arm that is a bunch of different Ophiocordyceps species. So there's the zombie fly, which is actually not Ophiocordyceps, it's Entomoptera. And the zombie fly is really cool because just like the ant, it has a way of adhering itself to surfaces, but because it doesn't really have big mandibles that it can use to really anchor itself, instead the fungus turns its saliva into glue or a very sticky substance. So when it like sticks its proboscis out onto the surface, it gets stuck there. It's like glued to the surface. So that's a really cool fungal phenotype. But there's also the wasp, and then there's, you know, that beetle larva that I showed you. There's versions of that that infect the adults. So, I have a lot of tattoos that are related to science that I think really just highlight my adventure from basically discovering the microscopic world to where I am now.
That's we have another question. Okay. So, Emre, again, to what extent could one claim that drugs are hacking the heterogenic system. Sorry, I'm struggling today. Are converting people into zombies?
Again, when we're talking about zombies, at least in the terms that I use in this talk, we're talking about pathogens that manipulate behavior specifically to reproduce better. All right. So there's probably a million other ways you can talk about zombies, like the speaker, for example, gave the impression that she felt like a zombie, right? Because she was sick. So like, you know, or like the Cranberries song where it's just mindless people. Like some people would say that your phone makes you a zombie because all you do is stare at your phone, right? But at least in the terms that we use in biology, when we're talking about zombie fungi and zombie parasites, the chemicals don't really make any sense because the chemicals aren't, you know, after the goal of reproducing, right? It's if you're talking about like a pill or whatever that you take, the pill doesn't care if you take it or not. So at least in that case, I would say that it's not really a comparable thing.
So is it an accepted scientific term?
So zombie fungi, yes. So in the scientific literature, we often refer to them as zombie making or behavioral manipulating are the two terms that we use.
Okay. But then did the kind of the fantasy version come first and it was adopted by the biology?
Like a lot of scientific things, often you have fantasy as the inspiration for real life. I mean, we're all still waiting on our hoverboards, but you know, other things like space travel and stuff were all things that we had in our mind well before we actually had the means to do them. Look at Jurassic Park, for example. Jurassic Park was, what, like 50 years old at this point, or maybe even older than that. Michael Crichton wrote that book a long time ago, way before we even really had the tools to sequence genomes, let alone do the types of genetic modification that they do in that book. So yeah, oftentimes science fiction is the beginning of our, you know, aims to look at some of this stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. And since I don't see any more questions cropping up, I'd love to say thank you so much for joining us today. And I'm going to take another minute to share all of William's socials. I would definitely check out the TikTok channels. I had a bit of fun looking at those today. And yeah, thank you again for your time.
No problem. And just one last thing I'd like to say, in addition to thanking you for inviting me to talk with you guys, I actually am surprised I didn't get asked the question, can these fungi infect humans? Which is usually the first question that I get asked at my talks. And I just want to reassure everybody out there who enjoyed the talk that, you know, these things are in no way a threat to people whatsoever. So if you want to go out and find these, you don't need to, you know, wear gloves when you're picking them up or anything like that. And there's certainly no need to be afraid of them. You know, there's a lot of differences between mammals and insects that really prevent the types of host shifts that we see. So while it might be feasible for a fungus to jump from, you know, a beetle to an ant, the differences in temperature and body regulation and all those things make it impossible for something like that to really hurt you. So I hope I leave everybody with a, you know, on a good note, we're not terrified of the zombie apocalypse. And again, you know, if you're interested in this stuff or where to find these in your local parks, definitely check out our website or follow us on some of our social media platforms.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
Have a good evening.